Today we'll be talking about placental abruption. At the end of this presentation, students should be able to describe the clinical presentation of placental abruption, describe the epidemiology and risk factors for placental abruption, describe the diagnosis of third trimester bleeding, understand the pathogenesis of placental abruption, describe treatment options for placental abruption, and understand the range of possible outcomes. We'll start with a case vignette. Our first patient is a 23-year-old Gravida 2 para 1001 at 37 weeks and 4 days gestational age who presents to labor and delivery triage with intense cramping, which started approximately 1 hour ago. In the last 15 minutes, she's developed profuse vaginal bleeding. Her physical exam reveals increased uterine tone and fetal tachycardia. This case just demonstrates that the clinical presentation of abruption can vary. Our patient here has the classical presentation of painful third trimester bleeding. Abruption presents with varying degrees of severity. Acute onset vaginal bleeding with painful contracting uterus in the third trimester is classic. In these cases, the blood in the uterus has an irritating effect, causing uterine contractions. Additionally, the mother experiences abdominal or lower back pain secondary to this irritation. The fetus can be without effects, but most likely will demonstrate tachycardia and decreased variability. Of note, vaginal bleeding is not required for the diagnosis as the bleeding can be trapped behind the placenta. Additionally, a Cuvier uterus can occur, which is when the bleeding passes through the uterine wall into the peritoneal cavity or retroperitoneum. Acute abruption is thought to be secondary to an arterial bleed at the utero-placental junction. Conversely, placental abruption can also present with light chronic bleeding. This bleeding can be difficult to differentiate from other etiologies of third trimester bleeding, and a careful search for the most common cause must ensue. As there is decreased placental oxygen transfer, fetal effects include oligohydramnios, fetal growth restriction, and preeclampsia. Of concern is that this chronic type bleeding can rapidly convert to an acute abruption with catastrophic consequences. Placental abruption is quite simply the premature separation of the placenta from the uterine wall. As mentioned earlier, there are many risk factors and events which can lead to this. The most recent theories argue that the majority of placental abruption is related to chronic pathologic vascular processes, hence the association with smoking, maternal hypertension, and ischemic placental disease. Traumatic events can also cause abruption by creating shear forces between the placenta and the uterus. These lead to a common final pathway involving retroplacental hemorrhage. This separation causes impaired maternal-fetal oxygen and nutrient exchange, leading to fetal hypoxemia and eventual metabolic acidosis. Additionally, this bleeding can activate the maternal coagulation cascade, leading to disseminated intravascular coagulation, hemorrhage, ARDS, renal failure, multi-organ system failure, and eventually death if rapid aggressive treatment is not pursued. There are many risk factors for placental abruption. However, the most important is pregnancy, meaning this can happen to any pregnant woman regardless of risk factors. Risk factors can be separated into several themes. First are acute events associated with rapid uterine decompression. When the uterine volume rapidly decreases, such as with trauma, rupture of membranes, or delivery of the first twin, shear forces between the placenta and the uterine wall ensue, which can cause separation. Another theme is maternal hypertensive disorders. Maternal hypertension and cocaine use lead to increased vascular pressure, which can cause vascular rupture and ensuing hemorrhage. Finally, smoking and ischemic placental disease can cause microvascular damage, which can lead to retroplacental bleeding. The differential diagnosis of third trimester bleeding is long. Placental abruption is the first and presents with painful vaginal bleeding. Placenta previa occurs when the placenta is implanted on or near the cervix and bleeding occurs with cervical dilation or cervical manipulation. This is classically painless vaginal bleeding. Uterine rupture is a rarer event but can occur in labor when the uterine muscle tears open. This typically occurs at the site of a previous uterine scar such as a cesarean scar or myomectomy scar. Vasoprevia occurs when there is a marginal cord insertion into the placenta and the cord comes across the cervical os. Of note, this is often bleeding of fetal blood, which can be catastrophic as the fetal blood volume is very small. Other cervical or vaginal pathology can lead to vaginal bleeding, including cervicitis, cervical cancer, cervical laceration, or vaginitis. Finally, vaginal bleeding can be physiologic and occur with cervical dilation. This is referred to as bloody show. Placental abruption is primarily a clinical diagnosis. Diagnosis is based on patient history and risk factors, as mentioned earlier. Physical exam is performed rapidly yet thoughtfully. Abdominal exam will likely reveal uterine tenderness and hypertonicity. Speculum exam should always be performed prior to digital exam. This is used to rule out placenta previa. If a digital exam is performed in the face of placenta previa, then the placenta can be further disturbed, leading to fetal hemorrhage. Historically, speculum exam was performed under double setup, meaning that the exam was performed in the operating room with the capability of performing both vaginal or cesarean delivery expediently. Now, bedside ultrasound has been added to the obstetrician's armamentarium. Although ultrasonographic examination is insensitive for the diagnosis of placental abruption, it can be used to rule out other pathologies such as placenta previa or vasa previa. If ultrasound does demonstrate a retroplacental blood collection or clot, then the diagnosis is confirmed. Management of placental abruption. If abruption is suspected or diagnosed at greater than 34 weeks, then expeditious delivery should be pursued. In the absence of signs of fetal distress, and if the mother is hemodynamically stable, then vaginal delivery is optimal. Labor augmentation in the form of intravenous Pitocin and artificial rupture of membranes should be undertaken. In the event of fetal distress or maternal hemodynamic instability, then emergent cesarean delivery may be necessary. In either case, blood products should be prepared for rapid delivery, particularly packed red blood cells, fresh frozen plasma, platelets, and cryofibrinogen. In the preterm gestation complicated by placenta previa, the risks of prematurity must be balanced with the risks of reduced maternofetal oxygen and nutrient exchange. If there are no signs of fetal distress and the mother is hemodynamically stable without evidence of coagulopathy, then expectant management is the optimal course. Regular fetal assessment with non-stress testing and ultrasonography should be performed and delivery pursued if fetal distress is uncovered. Rogam should be administered if the mother is Rh negative. Likewise, maternal hemodynamic status and coagulation should be regularly monitored, and if abnormal, then a move should be made toward delivery. If neither of these occur and the pregnancy continues to progress, delivery should occur at or before 37 weeks, with the exact timing being provider-dependent and ranging from 34 to 37 weeks. Tragically, fetal demise secondary to hemorrhage or asphyxia does occur. In these instances, the care of the mother becomes the primary concern of the obstetrical team. In these situations, expeditious delivery should occur no matter the gestational age. Vaginal delivery is ideal because of the decreased maternal morbidity associated with this procedure. In these cases, the risk of maternal coagulopathy is greatly increased. DIC is a frequent occurrence and should be managed by rapid and aggressive blood product replacement. The latest data derived from the trauma literature indicate that massive transfusion should include both PRBCs, FFP, platelets, and cryoprecipitate. Blood products should be administered based on the clinical exam, as laboratory evidence of coagulopathy often lags behind the clinical situation, which can lead to catastrophic hemorrhage. Finally, cesarean delivery, referred to as a hysterotomy in the case of fetal demise, should be used for maternal indications such as uncontrolled hemorrhage. Outcomes for placental abruption are widely varied and largely dependent on the degree of placental separation. In cases where there is minimal or marginal separation at term, there may be no adverse maternal or fetal affects. Chronic abruption can lead to preterm birth and intrauterine growth restriction, which carry a range of neonatal outcomes ranging from NICU admission to permanent neurologic sequela or death. Maternal mortality is generally low, but morbidity can be high. Hemorrhage and DIC can lead to renal failure and multi-organ failure. Even when blood products are aggressively supplemented, ICU admission is common. Hysterectomy may also be performed if uterine bleeding cannot be controlled in any other way. In summary, painful third trimester bleeding is placental abruption until proven otherwise. Risk factors for placental abruption are varied. Both acute and chronic abruption can occur. Treatment is dependent on gestational age. And outcomes depend on the degree of placental separation. Here are a list of references for further reading.